Hallelujah, hallelujah. I do want to say greetings to Beit Yisrael, the house, the elect of Yah's election, His choice, His choosing. That what a great blessing that He has elected us to grant us the opportunity to hear His voice, His call, the essence of whom He is, what He is, and what He speaks unto His nation for great comfort and for the greatest assurance that one could ever have. And in this hour, we need that. I want to speak to the hearts, the lev, the leba, the mind of Yisrael tonight. I want to speak to the comfort of His people, that we must have our conscience and our minds massage constantly with Yah's truth. We must have confidence in Him. There is nothing else that's going to give us security, give us assurance, and to settle every issue in our life. Nothing else but truth. And so I speak unto the nation, into the one heart, the heart of Yeshua HaMashiach, that we all may have that same heart in us Yisrael. I do want to say and send our condolences into our hearts. His mother passed away, I believe, this morning. She was an elderly mother, and she passed away. And also our precious Ak Marcos, that he called me yesterday, and his mother passed away as well. So condolences unto them. We understand the magnitude of that. We must have confidence in Almighty Yah. So we know that there shall be pains and agony. And I said to my aunt, there are going to be tears, so just cry. You'll be all right after a while. All right? That's just the natural manifestation of a process. We see it here when we butcher a cow, how they gather around the cow, how they mourn the cow when the cow has surrendered its life for our delight. I want to teach Yisrael. I want to take my time, Yah's will. That is somewhat difficult for me to do, but we will trust Yah to do that tonight. I want to teach for the assurance of His nation that we are and we shall be tried, but not forsaken. We shall be Saraf. He is going to have to refine us. He is going to have to test us, to show us actually what's in us. He is the refiner. He is the one that examines us. And although He is the one that tests us, He will not neglect us at all. He will not forsake us. Azab. He will not neglect us. He will not abandon us. He will not forget us, because the Torah says so. That does not imply that we do not have an obligation to Him, because we do. And I want to begin here in the book, at the writings of 2 Corinthians, this tremendous agony of cry from Shaul. And to understand the depths, I want to take a little time and to examine almost every word in his statement as he writes unto those that how the great agony of his suffering for the sake of Torah, for the word of Yah. Yet he sensed the great richness of their support, and he supports them that they may be strong, that they may overcome and be able to forbear all the opposition or the agony that shall try them. 2 Corinthians chapter 4 and verse 8. I want to begin reading here. Jaul says unto the nation, us as a people, he uses the word acha, we are troubled. We are disturbed. There are times that we are afflicted. There's an agony in our minds that we do not know how to overcome. There is calamity. And the subtleties of those calamities, they tend to bear heavily upon us, that it produces this distress. We are always going to be troubled, Yisrael. He said, we are troubled on every side. Every circumstance, every situation, it produces trouble. And there are times we don't know how to navigate those agonies, those afflictions, and the conflicts in our own minds, that we may bring about the resolution of Almighty Yahweh, that we will be in shalom. He says, although we are troubled on every side, he says we are not overwhelmed. We are not atav. We're not overwhelmed by those circumstances. We have not been made feeble. We're not weak. We're not ready to throw in the towel and say unto Yah, it is it. I cannot go any farther. Although there is great trouble, we are acha, we are distressed. There are calamities in our lives. And it seems as though that they are monumental unto us, Yisrael. And yet through all of that, Yah doesn't allow us to be overwhelmed by those circumstances, that we do not grow weak, we don't turn aside from the instructions of the Torah of Almighty Yahweh. We cannot turn aside from the instructions of Yah. We cannot find the resolution by some kind of processing those calamities, afflictions, and we are going to produce a resolution by our own psychological bearings and our own being. It's not going to happen that way, Yisrael. He said, in all of that, we're not overwhelmed, we're not overtaken. He says that we are so book, we are so perplexed. We're so confused, we don't even think right. We cannot, in a coherent, cognate fashion, reason in our minds. We are confused. We have great conflicts in us. He says, not only that, this perplexity, it caused great agony in us. He says, but in all of that, I want us to be cognate of that word, N-O-T, not. He said, but not in Yaash. We're not in despair. It is not that we do not have the tikvah. We lay hold unto the promises of Almighty Yahweh. It's not that we doubt him. We lay hold to his promises. We are not despaired. We are not Yaash, that we do not have confidence in the resolutions that have been worked out before we were ever even thought of, Yisrael. Yah has prepared the way, and he has finished the way for us to walk in. And then he says there's a great radav. We are persecuted. Our minds are being assaulted by the ways of darkness and hell. There is this great pursuit of the enemy that pursue us, that pursue our minds to take root and to take authority in our minds. But again, he says, but not. Verse 9, but not, we're not azab. We're not forsaken, Yisrael. Yah has not abandoned us. He has not cut us loose. He has not turned himself away from us at all. He will not neglect us. He will not negate the promises unto Abraham, Yitzhak, and Yaakov. He will never do that. He will not abandon his people. Yet we are not forsaken. And what a profound promise that Yah grants unto us. Twice the word not has been used in this context of teaching unto the people of Israel. He says, we have been cast down. We are brought down to the lower gates of darkness, that our minds do not relish the things of Yah. He said, but I want to tell you, but not, we have not been we have not been destroyed. We have not been exterminated. We have not been eliminated. Yet we are not destroyed. We have not been destroyed. He said, the purpose of that is this. I want us to hear this carefully. He did not say sometimes in the next verse. He said, but always. It is a continuous thing. It is not going to cease, nation of Israel. He said, always bearing about in the body, in our being, what? The dying of the Master, Yeshua HaMashiach. We're always bearing that about. And we must become cognizant of that and conscious of that. We're always bearing about the death of Yeshua HaMashiach. That's why we die daily. We die out unto the will of our nature, to our habits. We're always. It is a continuous process. We're always bearing about in our body the death or the dying of the Master, Yeshua HaMashiach. For what reason? That the life, the chayil, the strength, the nourishment of Torah, the nurturing of Torah, revelation, and wisdom. He says also that the life also of Yeshua might be made manifest in our bodies. That the light of Torah will shine in the midst of all of darkness, in the midst of the great agonies of captivity. It will be the lights of Torah that reverberate in our lives and replenish us, that we will grow strong, Yisrael. There's nothing like light. It awakens the senses of our mind, our eyes, our body. It awakens us, and that is what Yeshua does. He awakens us to the great despair, to the trouble, the trials on every side, but you're not overwhelmed. You're not overtaken. You are not attacked. You have not been subdued by it. You have not grown weak. You have not allowed those things to overcome you, that you forget Yeshua HaMashiach. We can't forget him. We can't forget the works that he has done. That's why we must experience every day, always experience in the death, because we know that there is life in the death. And so when we experience the death of him dying, we experience the life of the power of him raising up by the Ruach of Yah from death. So it is the power of this living Torah, the Ruach of Yah, that gives us life. And so those trials and the Sarah, the great agony, or the testing that Yah shall test us, it is just a small thing for the moment. It cannot be compared to the great revelation that shall be revealed, not just to come, but the life of Yeshua in us daily. And we maturate, we will mature from day to day to day to day. That must be the process, Yisrael. And then he gives us this great revelation of assurance in verse 11. He says this, for we who live are always, again the word always, verse 10, always bearing about. He said, for us that do live, we are always delivered to death. That we destroy the elements of our flesh and the spirit that cause us to go contrary and to forsake Almighty Yahweh. We are always, not sometime, delivered to death for Yahshua's sake. It's for his sake that the power of Almighty Yahweh may be made known or manifest in the midst. It is not some actions that we take in our physical state. It is just we believe and we have confidence and we trust Yah. We have emunah. And when we have emunah, we are firm. We are faithful. That's what emunah is. It is firm. It is steadfast. And it is unmovable. And we must manifest that Yisrael. And the power of that being recognized in us, we must always bear about the death of Yahshua in our body. For us who live are always delivered from death for Yahshua's sake. For what reason? Only one reason. That the chayil, the life, the strength, the nurturing of Yahshua also might be made known or manifest in our mortal flesh. It will be seen, it will be made known in our physicality, in our physical being, that man will see the very depths of the life of Yahshua HaMashiach in us Yisrael Ya'il. So we rejoice in the great dying or the death daily of our physical and natural state, that the power of his truth may arise in us with great power of the promise of the resurrection Tigvah that we have in Yahshua HaMashiach. So although we are persecuted, trial will perplex, do not allow these things to perturb you or turn you away from Yah. Because he said, yet through all of that, Shaul said, in the midst of all of that agony, in the midst of all of that overwhelming, and those circumstances that overwhelm us, persecuted. We are radaf. We are persecuted. He says, but not forsaken. The enemy is adamant in pursuing us. Even our own thoughts pursue us. Even our own words overpower us. He said, we are persecuted. But the comfort of all of that, in the death, the dying in our body, we are not forsaken, Yisrael. Yah has not forsaken his house, his nation, his people. But there's a great reward for them. Well, my friend, you don't understand the agony of all of my trouble, this distress, this affliction of my mind, where there is a resolution, who could speak with a pure purpose and intent to understand the great deliverance of that than Dawid? And he gives us information here in Tehillim, Psalms, chapter 9. This is beautiful here, and verse 9. This is our resolution, and he gives us the resolution for it all. He says to us, Almighty Yahweh, he will always be our, do you hear that? He will always be, not sometimes, he will be a refuge, a saga. He is a refuge to us. He is a place that his height or the depth of Yah, they are inaccessible for the enemy to touch us. So he will always be our refuge. A refuge for the oppressed. A refuge when? In time of sarah, in time of great distress, when you're in the strait. When there are great calamity in your mind and in your heart, when there's great adversity, affliction, he will always be that saga, that place whereby even your natural mind cannot assess it, cannot get to the zenith of the pinnacle of that, but through the power of the Ruach, we're able to access or to enter into that. We have the ability, Yisraya, that it is not inaccessible to us, but it is accessible to us, that we can enter in. He is our refuge. When we are troubled in times. And so that is plural there. It's not a time of trouble, but it is times of trouble. He is the one. He is our refuge in the times of trouble. Listen to this carefully, the next verse. And they that yada know your name, we must grant, we must give. They will put their bodak, their confidence, their trust in you. Why? For you, O Yah, have not azab. You have not forsaken. You have not abandoned your nation. You will not neglect your people. You will not leave them behind. We must put our trust in him, Yisrael. We can't put our trust in the strength of man, in the arm of his power and his ability that he boasts in, but we must put our trust, our confidence of great assurance in the written book of life. Yoshua HaMashiach is that book. We must trust him. He will not forsake us if we trust him. You don't have to have this monumental faith. We just must believe. We must have that which is as the grain of a mustard seed. And we can say to the mulberry bush, be plucked up and cast yonder, and it must come up, Israel. So we must trust. If we just trust him, what else are you going to trust in the midst of all of your afflictions and your troubles? What else are you going to trust in? Tell me, please. There is nothing you can trust in but this source of life. You can't trust in your finance. You can't trust in your own reason. We must. He will not forsaken us. He will not abandon us. He will not azab. He will not neglect. He will take care of us. He is our refuge. He is that place that is inaccessible by the powers of darkness. We must trust him. That's our resolution. How do I trust? Just believe. Don't allow the enemy to wrestle that or take that from your left. Just simply believe and build on that every second, every minute, every hour, every day. Just build on that. What if I fall? Well, just get up, clean yourself up, set yourself apart, and start at ground zero again. And you won't make that same mistake, or you won't fall after the manner you just got up from, Yisrael. He is a great refuge. Just trust him. And he will not, again, in OT, he will not forsake one of us at all. And although there are times in the midst of great agony that we have the sense that he has forsaken us, because we believe that the perplexity of our problems and the calamity of me is greater than anyone. I have never thought that. I have never thought that. I have never believed that, because I can look at the expanse of the world. And I can see a mother with her children, the husband is deceased. And she has barely enough bread to feed them. And yet she presses on daily. And she strives every single day. And not with the comfort and the assurance of the Torah of Yah. Yet she doesn't give up. And she doesn't give in. I can see the extent of poverty in this world. I'm glad that I can take a bath or shower in the evening. I'm glad that I was able to chew my food and digest it today and enjoy the sweetness and the saltiness or the bitterness of what I was able to consume. I had bread and rice today, which was more than enough to satisfy me. So our circumstances are not as grave as we paint them to be, Israel. And if we trust Yah, He will never azab. He won't leave us. He will not forsake us. He will not abandon us. And He will not leave us to that situation to overtake us and to destroy us. Because we have the process of Yahshua dying in us daily. Why? That power of that life in that flesh will resurrect us from any form of death to separate us from Yah, that we don't believe Him nor trust Him. And when the time of great agony and trouble comes, there will be this hour that we all will have this question. And we will ponder and we will wonder. Yahshua did. It's written here in Matthew. In chapter 27, in the midst of the great agony of death, the thralls of death, the pains of death, Matthew 27, one verse I want to read. Verse 27. It tells us the precise hour, the ninth hour, Matthew 27:46. And in the precise hour, the ninth hour, Yahshua, he cried in great agony that his voice was heard. He cried with a loud voice, saying, Eli, Eli, Eli. He calls him, Limana Shabbatani. That is to say, my great Almighty Yah, my great King, why have you, Azab, why have you forsaken me? And we will cry that cry. But yet when we understand that He is in control of all things, we have confidence, then we will cry, not my will be done, Yah. But it is your heart, face the pleasure of your great pleasure. It will be worked in me. We will all cry. We all have speculated that He has left us. We all have speculated that there is none that endure the kind of pains that I endure. We all will reason in our minds that nobody understand my agonies and my troubles. That's not so, Yisrael, is not so. Yahshua knew His purpose. We know our purpose. And that is the death of Yahshua HaMashiach in our bodies. That the power of that life, we can get up, we can stand up against the gates of hell, against the powers of darkness, and we can stand up and resist. We submit ourselves unto what we hear tonight. Then we resist the powers of hell, and the enemy must flee. Not that he will not flee, but he must flee, Israel. Even the thoughts of our minds, even the way we process it, we will see the altering of that and the change of that. So Yahshua cried. Why? What is the reason that you have Zab? You have neglect to understand my great agony. You have abandoned me, Father, and we think that. We reason within ourselves in the midst of trouble. Shaul said, trouble on every side. But that's trouble. You sail to the east, there's trouble. The winds are strong. You take the warm south breeze of the wind of the sea and the turbulence of the sea, and the tsunami rises up against you. You take the northern turn and the iciness of the waters of the northern route, and the turbulence and the undercurrents began to pull, and you're fearful, not knowing which way to turn. And then you believe that the eastward bound currents will take you to safety. And then you find yourself abandoned, marooned from what? Truth, where your mind doesn't even think about the word of Yah. And so when we're in trouble, we try to reason from a mind that is not the mind of Yahshua HaMashiach. We must let that same mind that was in Him, it must be in us. He cried this, but He understood the pledge of His Father. He understood the reward in the great gem and the gems that He had amassed us, even in this generation, that we will be the gems of his chesed, his crown of honor, and his crown of beauty. That's worth living for me it is. It's worth living for me. It's worth embracing that and tying myself and joining myself unto that Yisrael. So we're going to be Yisrael. He's going to refine us, Yisrael. We're going to be tested. We're going to be tried. We bear in our bodies the marks of Yahshua HaMashiach. And then we must all confess our sins and acknowledge our evil ways before Yah. That was one of the greatest cries of Ezra. Not only his sins, but the sins of the nation. I want to read this. You can turn to the first writings of Ezra. It is in your standards, Keith V. First Ezra, chapter 9. And verse 8, I want to begin reading. He says unto the Most High, and now for a little space, rachem, or supplication, has been shown from Yah. So even in this moment, he shows his great racham, his great kindness toward us. He said, supplication, it has been shown from Yahweh our Abba to make sure that he leaves us a remnant to escape. There must always be a remnant that will escape the onslaughts of darkness and the powers that Yah has raised up. Let no one bemuse you and trick you to think that there's some kind of organization that controls all things. It is Almighty Yahweh. That is so silly, so immature. And these are the ones that think that they're spiritual. As the old folks would say, he got it all under control. He controls life and he controls death. There's nothing he does not control. That's all right with me. If I know the one that rules and commands everything, that's all right with me. So he got it all under his mandate. And there is nothing that you perceive to be strange that has happened unto you that Yah has not ordained. For your process of preparation, he prepares us. Oh, I want to see him. You got to be pure to see him. You got to be right. You can't be getting right. You must be right. There's a remnant that shall escape. For what reason? And to give us a secure hold in his Kodesh place, that our sovereign master Yahweh, he may lighten, open our ayin, spiritual depth beyond reason of the mental processing or the mental ability to understand the depths of it. He will open our ayin, he will light our eyes. And then I like this part, what Ezra says. He's going to give us a little reviving, or michiah. He's going to give us a little reviving. He's going to preserve our lives. He's going to give us some a little preservatives there, Yisrael. He's going to give us a little reviving, a little michiah, even in the midst of what? Our bondage, and our agony, our pain. That's all right, Yisrael. Yeah. There's nothing like a tumultuous, strenuous labor all day, and then you're revived by the coolness of a drink of cool water from the tremendous attack of the sun that scorches on one's head, and then one is revived by refreshing one's body. A cool bath and can wash away the filth, as Yeshua by his dung washes away the sin stain from our lives, and that we'll revive for a moment, just for a space of time, that we can give him the greatest of honor and esteem for the great works he has done. And he is going to, hear that, give us just a little revival. He's going to preserve the substance of life in us. He's going to give us a little bit of that. Yet Yah, Almighty Yahweh, he is our Abba, is he not? Yet Yah, our Abba, through all of that bondage, has not, again the word not, forsaken us in all of our great agony, in all of our bondage, in all of our persecution, in all of our affliction. He has not, if we just believe, just trust him, but has extended. I love this part here. I know it's somewhat repetitive in my speech. I love every part, but there are words that, to me, every word stands out when I read it. When I study the Torah, every word is profound to me. So it stands out. So he's going to give us just a little revival. What is that? What a little that a Sadiq man has is greater than all the riches of the wicked. So if he gives you just a little micha, just a little revival, just a little life, is greater than all the wealth of Donald Trump. And that's a fact. That's a fact, Israel. He's going to give us that little bit of revival. He's going to sustain us in our bondage. And yet he has not forsaken us in our bondage, but has extended steadfast love kindness to us in the sight of the kings of Persia, or the rulers and the powers that be, that pursue us continuously, and the enemy does. He pursues us in our minds, our thinking, to develop, to alter, to change. So he has given us revival even in the midst of all that in our bondage. And again he says, hallelujah, to give us revival. In verse 9, to recover us, to make us alive, to set up the bed of Yah, our Abba. He has given us the power to set up the bed. For know ye not that your body is the bed of Yah? That's where he dwells. Our body is the bed, the house of Yah. We must restore the house. We must root out and tear out all those things that are offensive unto Yah, Yisrael. We can't wait till tomorrow. We must do it now. Now is the time of Yosha. We hear the Torah of Yah. We don't harden our hearts. So now is the time, not tomorrow. So when you hear, you take heed to what he says, because he's speaking to us, hallelujah. And not only that, we must amad, we must repair. We must continue to abide, to endure. We must repair the desolation thereof, and to give us the walls of Yehuda in Yerushalayim. He's going to establish his people, his nation, in the city of Shalom, that in our minds we have Shalom in the midst of despair and persecution. We have Shalom in the midst of all of our agony and our pains. We have the covenant of Yah, the Brit, that calls Shalom to dwell in us. We're the city of light. We're salt that has fragrance and flavor. We have not lost our fragrance and the purpose of salt. Yisrael, he will not forsaken us. He's going to cause the light to shine in us that we may build the city. And he says in verse 10, and now, O Yahweh, our Abba, what shall we say? All you have done to us and for us. What shall you say? after this, for we have forsaken your commandments, your mitzvot. We have forsaken to pray, to love each other, to be kindly affectionate to one another, to consider one another to be your brother, your ach, your chosin, keeper, the Ezra, the helper. We have forsaken all that. That's what his commandments are. These six tells us how to love one another. We have forsaken the order of Yah. And yet in all of that, he calls us to rise this morning. Yeah. And calls us to get up. Yet we forsake his authority. We abandon the way that he commands us to walk. And through all of that, he said, Yah said this in Ezra. Through all of that, Ezra 9:9, yet Yahweh our Abba has not, again the word not, forsaken. He has not forsaken us in our bondage. He has not forsaken us. He has not. He has not abandoned his nation, his people. Although we're in bondage, in the bondage of our own sins, our own corruption, our wickedness, our evil, sadistic ways, because we forsake the commandments. We have disdain for what he commands us to do. We try to reason within ourselves as to the best alternative or the best way to proceed. There's only one excellent way to proceed. That's the way that he commands us to do it. And through all of that, yet Yah has not forsaken us, although we have forsaken him. We have abandoned him. We have azab. We have neglected our responsibilities unto him. And we're guilty of that, Yisrael. We're guilty of that. We want to present ourselves as though that we are not, but we're guilty of that. But full of our own sins and our corruption. That's what the Sarah is. It is a smelting process. It is to refine us and get this trash out of us. He's got to get the trash out. And that means he got to heat it up a little hotter. We got mess in us. We got trash in us. We got a bunch of mess in us, Israel. We got a bunch of mess in us. We're defiant to him. We're rebellious. We're stiff-necked. We're stubborn in our own hearts. Yet in all of that, he doesn't forsake us. He doesn't leave us for the dogs to eat our bones. He only allows the dogs to eat the bones of Jezebel, Isabel. Yet he doesn't forsake us, and we forsake him. We will turn away from the mandates of Yah to satisfy a certain component of me and those that we're in association with. We can't do that. Yahshua, although he cried out in the midst of the agony of death, he did not abandon. He did not forsake Yah. He did not neglect the call and the purpose of his life. And we neglect to do that faithfully. That's why he tried us to refine us, that in death we're going to call on him. Like Yahshua in the midst of the throes of death, he said, it's not my will. It's not what I think, but I know that you know, because I am you, because I'm the power of your voice, your words, and you know. Nevertheless, not what I think is best, not my pleasure, but your will be done. And the will of Yah must be done. The will of Yah must be done. Period. Who can find one that is as faithful as him and care for us? We're not even worth caring for. We're not even worth it. Yet even, and notice as I'm going to conclude when I finish, that the word not in all the scriptures that I will use not forsaken. I will not. It's used 12 times. 12 tribes of Yisrael. Oh, I don't measure things out when I study. I'm a student, and I labor all the time. I just don't read. I study the book. I want to tell you something. I want to tell all you parents. I'm telling you now. When I was a kid, Granny would always look over and make sure I was in line. I want you all to keep these youngins in line. I don't like them little playing. I don't like that, all right? I'm telling you. I want them to learn how to sit. From Seriya to Sippy to your youngins and yours as well. He's the only little fellow that leans on his mom and sleep like that. Now, these other ones don't do that. Sit up like a young man. Let him lay down. That's not to take away from her love from him. I don't care if y'all don't like me. And that's a fact. No other little boy does that. I don't see it with him. I don't see it with him. Now, let's get real. It's such a distraction. It's a great distraction. When a man labors like this, he lays down the truth. I'm not going to allow the youngest to distract me. It is constantly that way. I want them to stop. You know, when I was a kid, I was talking to Zachary, same thing in the Church of God in Christ or Baptist. My grandmother sit there and she would look, because you knew when you were doing something wrong, you would look at her. And when you would look, she was always looking. I don't care if you don't like me. I don't care if you don't appreciate me. I don't care if your little juvenile feelings are offended. It just can't be, Yisrael. You need to grow up and stand up. Now, don't distract me. Hallelujah. They're sleepy. That's all right. I don't have no problem with them going to sleep. You teach them. I tell you, one of the worst things I did, I'm going to finish the teaching. I was in the fifth grade, and I never forgot. I was attending Double Oak School, elementary school. I'll never forget. It was about 1963, 64, 65. So I was in the third grade. And so at that time, you understand, in the 60s, there were very few telephones in the community. We didn't have one. So the teacher gave me a letter, said, take this home to your mother. Well, I was excited. There was jubilation. She gives me a letter. She's going to say something nice to my mother about me. And my, what a beautiful reward. I was excited. I didn't know what the letter said because she had sealed the envelope. And I knew better than to open it. And I walked to school. So I was so excited. My mother working. I believe at that time she was doing work at a dry cleaners. You had large dry cleaners in those days that facilitate communities. They facilitated. And so when I got the letter, I held onto it with security. Didn't have no book bag. Walked with my books on the moms. She got home from work. I ran with esprit and excitement and said, Mama, I forgot the teacher's name. Here. She opened the letter up. And the letter was addressed to Miss Roberts. I want you to deal with David because he fell asleep in the class today. Not five or six times. You need to be attentive to that and give him early rest. Well, what I realized was I was doomed. I couldn't watch the Green Hornets or Batman because Mama said, boy, 7:30, make sure you're ready for bed by 8. Come on, I was a young lad. But I tell you what, from that day, I never slept in school again. Never. Because once he gave, once he kind of, she did that, I don't know, it was for a long time. Batman at that time came on at 7. I could watch Batman, but Green Hornet came on at 8. And I would sit there, lie there in bed, trying to go to sleep, and I couldn't sleep because the Green Hornet, Batman, and Robin talked to me. But I knew better after that. It made an impact on me. And I did not fall asleep in school again. So if we had that discipline then, we can carry out the same discipline now, Yisrael. We didn't distract. We sat. They taught us posture, and we sat erect. They have enough time to play. Not in here. They can sleep at home. Not in here. Little mama at home. I'm not taking away our love from him. There's a time and a place for everything. It's sad that we're a people. If he goes to the playground, he doesn't lay on her. Now stop that. I don't ever see him laying on his mama. Now stop that, you all. I don't care if you get mad at me. We've been married for a long time. She's been mad at me, so what? Now stop that. It's destructive. It takes away, and I have to stop and do this. But I don't get weary in doing this. Don't think I do, because I'm going to nip it in the bud. I hate to see the people of our hue, how the young men, the young women are ostracized, how they're being characterized. It's sad. It's sad. Teach them how to sit up. I know the benches are not the most comfortable, but you can bring a pillow. But when I was a kid, you sat on the hard ones. And you did not budge. And you never chewed any gum. And if you, quote, were good after service, Granny didn't have peppermint like we have today. She had a peppermint cane. And you were happy for her to break your hard piece of that and reward you. Now, come on, Yisrael. I shouldn't have to do that. Period. Put them to bed. Make them go to bed. They lay there. They will go to sleep. Make them lay down. And that is a problem in this generation. We allow the youngest to stay up all kinds of crazy, strange hours. It wasn't like that when I was a kid. 12, 1 o'clock at night, that's insane. It should not be. There have been times that Zacchaeus young and spend the night, and they say, well, we stay up to 11 or 12. No, sir. Mama say, no, you're going to bed at 9. And I would say, you're no fun, Ima Rafi. You're such. And Papi, I said, I tell you, Ima, let's stay up to 9:30. Well, at 9, they're almost sleeping anyway. No young enough at 11, 12 o'clock at night, p.m. I don't care if it's Friday night or Saturday night. You discipline them. You train them. I train myself. I don't need no alarm clock. I get up 5, I wake up. I don't need that. You train them. When do you start? When they're young. I don't care if these little fellas go to sleep, but I don't want them playing and acting silly in y'all's house. I don't want that. I don't care whose younguns they are. I don't care if it's their younguns, and I don't care if it's their younguns. It makes no difference. I don't care if it's his younguns. Give them the things to play with. Stop it. Teach them how to open the book. She will sit with me and she will, can I take your scripture? And she'll find the scripture. Teach them those things. Come on, Israel. It's a sad shape our children are in. We don't want to deal with it. We want to leave it alone. So we let them run wild like beetles in the house. They do what they want to, the way they want to do it. It's wrong to do that. My life was so disciplined that I say this and I'm going to finish. We had horror movies that would come on Friday night. And they didn't come on until 11. I'm not talking about a 10-year-old kid. I'm talking about 13, 14 years old. I could never stay up that late. And I would try to drink black coffee. 10, 9:30, I'm buzzing out. 10, I'm holding on for dear life. And I'm looking at the clock to say, and I could not. 10, I was in bed. Summertime, 8, I was up. And I played all day, and I ran, and I hustled to make money picking blackberries and whatever I could. So let's get this together, you all. It's not a place of lounging and romancing and making love and all cozy. You do that at home. That's why we'll stop men when they come in with women. You're not going to do that here. I don't care if it's your wife. It's not a romantic house. Fall in love with Yahshua, all right? Now, don't interrupt me, you all, and you either out there. Hallelujah. You might as well love me. Who else are you going to love like that? You might as well. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Listen to the Torah. Those words of Ezra, they were profound and direct. Again, Ezra 9:10. Excuse me, you all. Although we have forsaken Yah's commandment, he has not forsaken us. This is one of the greatest assurance we can resort to here in Sirach. I want us to hear the words precisely. In Sirach chapter 2, verse 8, I would have begun reading to verse 11. Now hear this. This is the assurance of the nation, his people, his elect. Listen to what it says. You who yira, who yare, who fear Yah, trust in him. If you don't fear Yah, you don't trust him. We must fear Yah to trust him. You will understand what I conclude here. You that fear Yah, you trust him. And he says, and your reward will not, not fail. You're not going to lose your reward if you fear Yah and trust in him. We're so easily offended by the smallest of things. That's how juvenile we are. We get upset, our little emotion, it troubles us. We that trust Yah, we must fear him. There's a process, and your reward will not fail. Again, he implies in verse 9, you who fear Yah, you take the, you desire, you look forward to that which is tough. For everlasting joy, and for the great kindness of Almighty Yahweh. He tells us this. We must go back and consider the ancient generation. We got to look at our forefathers. We got to go back to the 60s and the 50s and the 40s and the 30s and beyond that. See how they did things. He said, consider the ancient generation and see. Whoever trusted in Yah and whoever called upon him was not, never did Yah overlook that one. We must trust Yah. We must have confidence in him. We must call upon him. He never overlooks us. As they don't know how they're going to be, but as they're going to quote, as they're going to trust aloud. That was a resolution in the hearts of the people, unquote. We were ignorant, but they had a resolution. And although they were ignorant, they were unlearned, they could not read to the extent that we can. But they understood every word. They held on to every word that a man would say. They didn't have the vocabulary like we do today. But it wasn't tainted by the form of wickedness we see today in us. Yah will never overlook us. He will never overlook us. He will never overlook us at all if we trust in him. We must consider the ancient generation and see, whoever trusted in Yah, they were not put to shame. He's not going to make us ashamed of him. He's not going to put us to shame. As the proverbial proverb, leave us out to dry. He's not going to do that. Or whoever preserved in the fear of Yah was forsaken. You fear Yah, he cannot forsake you. The fear of Yah, you know man has wisdom. You know woman has knowledge of wisdom. When one begins to fear Yah, those who fear Yah, he has never forsaken. Or whoever called on his name was overlooked. Why? For Yahweh is full of compassion and kindness. Yistomer, he runs over. He is full of chasid. He's full of compassion and kindness. And he is long-suffering. He endured with us. He endured our childlike nature and our immaturity, our complaining and our murmuring. He's long-suffering. He is long-suffering. And he is very, not just pitiful toward us. He's very pitiful. It's almost like a mother pitying her child, or father pitying his son. He's very pitiful to us. He's very pitiful. Very. Beyond measure. Extremely. Why? He forgives sins. And he saved us in the agony in the times of all of our affliction. That's what he does. He saves us from our sins. That's how pitiful he is. He knows that we're nothing but mere flesh. And then he saves us from all of our sins. And then he, in the midst of all of our affliction, he lays his hands upon us. What a great blessing. I want to fear him. Teach me, Yah. Teach me your ways. Show me. I don't care if it comes out of the mouth of a babe. I want to hear truth. I want to. This is our assurance, the book. You're not going to get it by some kind of promise through some sensual talk that one will say to you. He is the one that speaks to us. He doesn't forsake us. He will not forsake us. We got to fear him, though. We got to trust him. We got to obey him. I don't want to step into death alone. I don't want to try that angle. I don't want to go that way. Even you're sure that the body that contained him, the word created death. Life and death was in the power of Yahweh. He put before us life and death. Tav and Ra. He tells us what to choose. So I don't want to take that journey through the curtains without him. I don't want to take no chance. Well, what if it's false? I'll take my chances on that. That I will. I'm taking my chance with that. Let it be. But I know it's life in me. That's why I know it's not false. It picks me up, as the old folks would say. It sets everything in order. It calls life to flourish. It calls joy and strength to fill my heart in the midst of all of agony and trouble. So no, you can't convince me it's not real. It's more real than what I see. Hallelujah. Isn't that so, Yisrael? Sure it is. He is full of compassion and kindness. He is kind to us. As the old folks would say, he's kinder to us than we are to ourselves. We forsake him, but yet he opens up his word, his Torah, his heart in Yahshua HaMashiach, that we can hear a word and become convinced. We can hear a word and become convinced, and it calls us to repent of our sins. Yah is faithful, Yisrael. He loves us with such great love and with such great agony of love. He gives us an example that is perfect and shows us the parallel quickly in Yeshaya, Isaiah, chapter 49, verse 13. He tells us to bring forth Shiram, sing, O Shemayim, O heavens, and be glad with exuberant gladness of excitement, trembling fear, because you know you're in the presence of Yah. He tells us, O earth, he says, and bring forth into the Shiram, O mountains, you strong ones, you mighty ones. Why? For Yahweh has comforted. He is the one that has Noham. He has been moved by the great pity upon his nation, his people. He has comforted his people. He comforts us tonight. He shows pity on us tonight. And will have kindness upon the Oni. We are afflicted. We are poor. He will have kindness upon the afflicted. And he proposed something to us here. Listen. But Tizayon or Sion said, Yahweh has forsaken me, and my sovereign's Abaya, he has forgotten me. Listen to Yah's reply in Yeshaya 49:15. Can a woman forget her ul, her suckling child, that she should not have compassion on the son of her womb? And Yah answered and said, yes, they can. A mother will forget their child, the one that sucked on her breast and the one that came from her womb. He said, but I'm greater than a mother. My love is stronger than that. She will forget the one that came out of her womb. He said, yes, they may forget. Sure they will. Yet will I not forget my people. Yeah, the mother may forget, and the father may forget, but Yah says, not I don't forget. I don't forsake my people. The mother may forsake the ul, the suckling of her womb, but Yah doesn't forsake those that draw from the shot of Yahshua HaMashiach, the breath of the living life of his Torah. He doesn't forget us. We're not even worthy the great rewards and the benefits of Yah. The mother will forget it, leave it to die. But Yah will never leave his people to die. He said, yes, she will forget. Oh, I know we say, oh, I will never, but listen, Yah said, she will and she can. But Yah says, I will not. The mother can, but not I. The mother will, but Yah says, I will not forget. I will not forget. I will not forget you. He's not going to forget us because he said it. It is a sure promise of Yah. Even in the midst of Mabel, we're here. He has given us a sure promise, a sure word, a sure confidence. Hallelujah. I want to read that for us. Yeremiah 51, verse 4. Jeremiah chapter 51, verse 4. I know that you that are listening, your agonies and your pains, understand the great pain of certain things in life. But Yah doesn't forsake his nation. We forsake him. We forget about him. I want us to hear this your promise to us, even in the midst of Bovin. Captivated by the Chaldeans in all, Jeremiah 51, two verses, verse 4 and verse 5. He tells us that the slain shall fall in the land of the Chaldeans. We see the slain falling in the land of this religious order and conscience of man that has gone away from Yah. He said, and they that are thrust through in her streets. This is a sure promise unto Yah, even as we sit here in Bavel. Yah says in verse 5, for Yisrael, in death, those that are dying around you in the midst of all of the calamity, for Yisrael has not been forsaken. Do you read that? He said they have not been forsaken. They're not going to be almond. They're not going to be bereaved with death with the sons because he did not do it in Mizraim. When the death angel came through, those that had the doorposts, the mind of Yahshua HaMashiach, death passed them. He said, for Yisrael, then Goshen, they were not forsaken. When death pursued everything that came out of the womb first. For Yisrael has not been forsaken, nor Yehuda of their great Abba Yahweh, of Yah, of hosts. Though their land was filled with sin against the Kodesh, one of Yisrael, our minds are full of sin against Yah. Yet he's pitiful in his kindness, he forgives us. And he draws us to the breast to drink as he draws us tonight. Even though you were tired and you didn't feel the best, he draws us again that we may come to the living well and we may drink of the living waters of life. He draws us to drink. And although we have sinned, and our land, our minds are full of every kind of corruption and every sin against the Kadosh One of Yisrael. Yet he has not, and you have not been forsaken. In all of your trials, your agony, Yah has not forsaken us. He has not abandoned us. And although it seems as though that he has neglected us, he is not one that will neglect his heritage, his people. He's going to root out that which is offensive unto him, but he's not going to neglect his people. For all have sinned and fallen. I'm glad. We all fall short of the very esteem and the beauty of Yah. Every single day, for all have sinned. So you can't point fingers at nobody. It's me, myself, standing in the need. You can't point fingers at here. Nah, it's me. That's so often that 90% of my prayers about me, my corruption, that's how I talk to Yah about me. What a vile thing I am, how wicked and how unappreciative and how vile I am. I have to get that right before I can pray for anyone. I can't pray for no one. But I'm not right when I stink to hell. Nah, you can, but I cannot. So deal with me until I sense the very death of me and the life of his true witness, Yahshua, rising up. Then I can pray for you. But until then, I cannot. And I'm not talking about saying a few words. No, that's my constant. It's consistent in me. And that's a fact. I don't say it to boast. I'm just telling you that he is plentiful. He is pitiful toward me. And I'm so glad, all right? I'm going to close in a minute. Give me... Listen to this. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I want to read this. I want to close with these verses here. I'm not going to read this. Zazachin, Yarameya, I would say there's much more to this. But I want us to look in the book of Melachim, 1 Kings. 1 Kings. We are the house of Yah. We are the building. We are the body of Yahshua. 1 Kings chapter 6, verse 13. And Yah dwells with us. That's why Yahshua said, I must go. If I go not, then the Father cannot send the Comforter. This is the same application here in 1 Kings chapter 6, verse 13. Yah says, 1 Kings chapter 6, verse 13. Remind ourselves of this daily. Yah said, I will dwell among the children of Yisrael. He did not say of the Goyim, of the nation, he's going to dwell, his place is going to be among the nation, his people. And then he says this, I love this, I will not. That's the promise. His immutability, he cannot lie. He said, I will not forsake my people, Yisrael. Now, he's never going to forsake those that prevail. That's why he said, your name is no more Jacob, but Yisrael, for you have prevailed, and we prevail. Yah says, this is our promise. He says, I will not, again the word not, I will not forsake my people, Yisrael. He says, do you not, Yada? Listen to this. He said, I will not forsake my people, Yisrael. He says, I will not forsake him. And this was the building of the house, the bed of Yah. This was the restitution and all of that. As I stated to us in 1 Corinthians quickly, 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 19. Do we not know, Yada, that our body is the bed, HaMikdash, or the bed, the house or the dwelling place of the Ruach HaKodesh, which is in you, which you have from Yah, and you're no more your own. But you know that our bodies is where his mind dwells, his law of life dwells in us, and we're no more our own. Our ways are not right. It is his ways that are right. We are no more our own. We belong to him, Yisrael. We don't think in a mind that is corrupt and evil. We think in the mind that we let the same mind, which is Yah's mind, Yahshua, let that mind be in us, that we may dwell in the strength of our Abba. In all of Yeremiah's great lamentation, his echand, the cries for the nation, he makes a statement that is the great assurance of Yah's people. He doesn't change. He doesn't get weary. He doesn't faint. And he doesn't alter one precept. He gives us this great assurance. In Lamentations chapter 3, 21 through 23, we got to always renew our mind or stir up our minds. He cries out, Lamentations 3:21. He said, this I recall to my mind. We got to recall the great benefits of Yah to our mind. Therefore, I have tikvah. I have a resolution that what Yah said, he is going to do it. It is of Almighty Yahweh's hasat, or his steadfast faithfulness, his kindness, his love toward me, his love kindness, that we Yisrael are not consumed. He hasn't killed us because he won't forsake his nation. He hasn't destroyed us because this is it. His compassion fails not. In all of our filthy ways, his compassion doesn't fail. When you seem as though that there's no one on your side, his hasad, his compassion doesn't fail. He's there. We just must believe. It is not some feeling you get. You just believe. Yeah, I will trust you. You just believe. You trust in what he has said. He is still there, and his compassion fail not. He is full of strength and love and steadfastness unto us. And then he concludes with this. He said, they are chadash. They are renewed. They are fresh every morning. Great is the faithfulness of Almighty Yahweh. God, all his faithfulness is so great. He renews it chadash every morning. He makes you aware. I woke you up. Stand in my promises, my truth. You may forsake me because a mother will forget her suckling. But you, I will never forget. He will never forget nor forsake his people. And when we understand the magnitude and the depths of that, we will be inspired to do right, to run this race and endure it until the end. We will want to love each other and do right by each other. As the old folks would say, do right There will be always the words of assurance my mother, my grandmother would give me. I didn't have a father. Do right, son. Do right. I said, don't care what, you just do right. Well, I didn't know what right was, but I understood that was a law of, that was proper, and that was a law of regard and respect. That's what they were saying. Just do right, son. Just do right. And so we just do righteous today. By obeying his commands, what he commands us, let us do it faithfully. May the riches of Yah rest upon you in Yahshua's name. I'm going to stop there. Hallelujah. That's enough bread for tonight, and not much meat, but that was enough bread. It was the lechem that our Zochim prays about all the time. So we got bread. May the riches of Yah rest upon you. All you that have joined us, may his riches inspire your heart. This time, let us stand to our feet. Hallelujah. And turn toward Yerushalayim. In all things we do, Baruch, you are above for all things. Bless your nation, your people. Bless the Achim, safe return home, and all your people, those that have come, the few, just those. Take them home safely. Heal the bodies, I pray, and heal the heart of our heart and those with him, his family, and also our precious Ark Marcos. Bless him, his Israel. Yeshua's mighty name, strengthen his heart. They will know that all is well, for all things work for the better of them that love you and those which are called according to his purpose. Bless them, I pray. We ask in your nation, scattered abroad throughout the earth, we ask in Yeshua's name. Hallelujah. 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 Yabarak nation, bless you all. Bless you all.